can we be world best milk producers and use less synthetic fertilisers, produce less nitrates? Or does a significant reduction in fertiliser usage imperil dairy farming? Really hard to get an independent voice here, someone without vested interest one way or another. But Pāmu is really interesting. Pāmu is the brand name for land court farming. They have 43 dairy farms, 8 of which are organic. So they're able to directly compare milk production and revenue between organic and non-organic farms. Organic farms don't use synthetic fertilisers. We're really grateful to welcome back to breakfast to continue this important, important discussion, Mark Julian, the General Manager of Dairy Operations for Pāmu. Mark, you're a great guest. I always learn something when you're on. Thank you for being with us. So 43 farms.
Good morning, John.
Thank you for joining us. 43 farms, 8 of which are organic. Is that right?
Yes, that's right. John, in terms of our dairy business.
Right. Yes. And can you tell me about nitrogen use on your organic farms versus your non-organic farms?
Yes, yeah, so nitrogen use on our organic farms, we reduced by up to 75%. And the organics that the organic source of nitrogen is through chicken manure largely. And what we find is that we use that as a sort of a replacement for nitrogen to still boost grass at certain times of the season. But talking to other leading sort of organic farmers that have been in organics for 10 years plus, a lot of them don't use any sort of form of bought-in nitrogen and rely largely on their pasture composition to provide that nitrogen naturally.
And I guess that depends on what region you're in, right? So we'll come back to that because I think that's a really important discussion.
Yes.
But so 75% reduction, organic versus non-organic. That's a hell of a difference, isn't it?
Yes, it is. I'd make the point too that in terms of our conventional farms, like a lot of other farmers out there, is we're constantly challenging the use of synthetic nitrogen as well. And I think that you'll see across the country that farmers are decreasing and being a lot more strategic with the use of that nutrient in their farm system.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's the feedback we're getting from farmers. So Mark, the really important question is here, what does that mean for revenue? So if you have less nitrogen, less fertiliser, does that mean fewer cows? Does that mean you are not farming as intensively?
So we talked last time, John, in the pure organic sense, it's about 30% less cows, and that is a result of less farm inputs, not just nitrogen fertiliser, but some of the other synthetic fertilisers, plus your purchase feed that you can't bring into a system under organics. So it's about 30% less cows in an organic system. In terms of a conventional system, we were seeing reductions in nitrogen use. One of the really interesting things that you opened the story with is that it's hard to get that independent advice, and it's hard sometimes for farmers to think about their farm systems and how they can make improvements. Just one lesson that we've learned over the last 3 years, we farm on the west coast of the South Island, 10 farms, around 9,000 cows, and we've reduced our synthetic nitrogen use by 25%, and the production is actually stable and actually increased. And it really challenged us to ask that question about how we're best using nutrients in the farm system.
Wow, so we're setting aside organic. This is straight up conventional farming. Can you repeat that for me, Mark?
Yeah, so we've reduced our nitrogen use through urea on the west coast by up to 25% over the last 3 years. You've always got to take into consideration the climatic seasons that we're having and how every season's not the same. But at the same time, we really challenge the people that advise our business, whether it's fertilizer companies or others, about who was asking that question before we started asking it. And I think that's a challenge for all farmers is to really challenge themselves in terms of the farm systems and inputs.
Mark, can I come back? So, I mean, that's such a staggering fact, and we're not comparing organic with non-organic. We're just talking about a reduction in straight conventional farming. Has your herd size stayed the same? In other words, are there fewer cows now?
They're slightly fewer, John, but largely static in terms of herd size.
Okay, wonderful. Now let's go back to our comparison of organic and non-organic, because Pāmu can speak directly to this with 8 organic farms. So a 30% reduction, is that right, in milk output? But what does that mean in terms of revenue? Is organic milk worth more?
Yes, absolutely. So there is a reduction in the total production out of the farm. But over the last 5 years, we've had an average of a $2 price premium in organics per kilo of milk solids versus conventional.
Right. So we are polluting less, we have fewer cows on the land, we're using no synthetic fertilisers, and you're getting $2 a kilo more milk solids return for organic?
Yeah, that's right, John. We're really pleased with our organic farm results. As we spoke about last time, is the challenge is the organic milk pool in New Zealand is about 1% of our total milk pool. And the market out there to keep on attracting those premiums is small and growing, but it's not like the conventional dairy farmers can switch to organics tomorrow in a mass scale event.
Okay, and that's really important. In fact, I'm looking at your conversions, right? They take about 3 years per conversion?
Yeah, they take 3 years. There is a transition payment above a base milk price that you get to help through the financial sort of reduction in those years in between. But yeah, there's a lot of knowledge that it takes to become organics. And what we're finding is that when you start taking away some of the levers that traditional conventional farmers pull, whether it's through synthetic fertilisers or your chemicals, your pesticides, herbicides that you use in the farm system, or even your antibiotics, is that you really start to push the focus back onto a farmer's core skill set, which is observation and proactive management, which we're finding a really renaissance, really, in terms of our farm team's skill sets around just traditional farming well.
That's really exciting. It's fantastic to hear that. And I find that inspiring. We don't. So it's important not to be prescriptive here. And there are dairy farms in regions where, for example, there isn't sufficient rainfall for nature to take care of grass growth, right? And I'm thinking of Canterbury. I mean, Canterbury is always the elephant in the room, dairy farming in Canterbury. So there are some areas where we will be better able to convert to organic or stay conventional but completely reduce nitrate use, synthetic fertiliser use, way more than other areas, right?
Yeah, absolutely, John. There's natural regional advantages, which is really interesting when we think about some of the issues that we're facing in terms of increases in nitrates in groundwater and some of the slow-moving waterways that we've got around Aotearoa. I think we need to step back and think about each region and its own unique challenges. But I think without fail, we can keep on asking that question as farmers about the best use of resources. And farmers naturally do this. Farmers are naturally innovative and really efficient with what they use. They don't want to see anything leak out of the system in terms of nitrate leaching, and they're really starting to focus on those greenhouse gas emissions too, which we're really glad to be part of that story and to be alongside those leading farmers in finding solutions.
Right. So you were telling us that actually the message is heard, many farmers are receiving it, and whilst not many are converting to organic, a lot of farmers are already thinking about nitrates and the difference they can make.
Absolutely, John. The new national water policy talks about 190 kilos of synthetic urea or use per hectare in terms of nitrogen balance. And if you look around the country, there's only a couple of regions probably nationally at an average that get near that or exceed that. A lot of our farming regions are using much less than that, which really talks to the fact that farmers are embracing stewardship. They're not pushing their farm systems to an absolute economic optimum. They are already thinking about how to transition and how to balance those capitals. And ultimately, farmers are thinking about passing on the land, I guess, to successive generations. And they live in the communities they farm in. So they're really worried about keeping the waterways in the best order they can be as well.
It's a hell of a good note to end on, but I've got a minute to go and I want to use it because you're a fascinating guest. And so I absolutely hear you, and I also think that the message you're making about the changes we can make to conventional farming and that farmers are already doing that is very powerful, and it's actually inspirational, so thank you, Mark. But I just want to go back to your organic conversions. So the eight farms you've converted to organic, at what stage does their profitability get anywhere near the levels that it was at pre-organic? Does it? Can it?
Well, what we're finding, like any change in farm systems, is that the first one was quite hard. And we found it was a rocky road. It might have been sort of 2 years into its full conversion. So you're looking at sort of a 4 or 5 year turnaround. But the successive conversions, we're getting there a lot quicker, and we're implementing those lessons learned, And what we're finding is basically within the first year, especially of getting that full milk price, organic milk price, it's beating the conventional farms. Out of our 43 farms this year just finished with the organic milk price in there, our two fully organic farms are in the top 10 of those 43 farms in terms of profitability, but also some of the other capitals that we measure our farms on in terms of how the sustainability of the people, the environment, and some of the animal reproduction and welfare factors.
So this really can be a win-win?
Yes, it can be a win-win in terms of the farm system change, but the big lesson for us is about taking some of those principles and applying them to a conventional farm system because, yeah, organics is good, but it's very small, but we can learn a lot from organics about conventional farming and doing it better.
Mark, Julian, what you're saying is so hot, someone's coming to put you out. It was great, Mark. We could just hear the siren. Mark, Julian, I can't thank you enough. And we really wish all farmers who are involved in this in some way or other well with this work. It's really important. Mark, Julian from Pāmu, very grateful for your time. Thank you.
Hey, John.